Hello, am I audible? Yeah, hi. So good morning, everyone. This is our pleasure. And first of all, I would like to thank Jessica and the India Dab Fest team, Akshay, and everyone for making this happen and inviting us for the talk. So today I'm talking about securing blockchain. So I'll be going through the different things like what we do in terms of security auditing and all those things, and what are the different kind of tools that we have. So first of all, let's just look into the blockchain variations. So there are different types of blockchains available. So the public blockchains and the private blockchains. So public ones, that is still not working. So the public one is the Ethereum SV, everyone knows. And the private blockchain comes like the Hyperledger Fabric is the one of the private blockchain. So mostly we will be talking about the public blockchains here in this talk. So as we know that the different types of blockchains, there are different types of blockchains are available for the different kind of uses. So like Ethereum, on Ethereum you can write the smart contracts and everything. And on Ripple, it's like cross-border payments mostly being used. Then we have a Monero for completely anonymous transactions. Then we have a Filecoin for decentralized file sharing. And so we would be talking about the Ethereum specifically because that is the one of the platform there we have the smart contracts or all those things are enabled. So in terms of, thank you. Yeah, so in terms of the components of the different clients, the clients in the node, there are different components under that client. One is kind of network and the processing, the storage. These are the three different layers. Those are there. So we would be mostly talking about the transaction processing here in this talk. So the transaction processing is like a virtual machine that mimics the behavior of a bare-bone machine. It executes software written for this virtual machine in a dedicated virtual environment. So this is the virtual machine that we have. Like Ethereum also has its own virtual machine. And if we see like the blockchains are having the different blocks and all those states in the code are coming from the blockchain and that has been fed into the virtual machine. Now, there comes like whatever transaction you want to perform. So those transaction and the data of the transaction is fed into the virtual machine as an input. And if those states are valid, then the state of the blockchain is updated into the new block. Now we look into the transaction processing, like the simple payments. So as we know, like the simple payments of the Bitcoin and all those things. So how this happens? So in the virtual machine, it has the instructions like load the state and check the rules, generate the new state. So first it loads the state, what is the current state from the blockchain. So like there are two things. One is rule and the current state. So the rules are like what are the rules would be applied onto the, this transaction and what is the current state of the transaction before making it happen. What was the current state of those variables, those would be affected. So here in case like the sender has a Y amount and the receiver has the Z amount. So once a new transaction comes in to the virtual machine that the, that says like sender, receiver, and input, and if the transaction is valid, if the amount is perfect, then only it will be updated. So if the state and the verification is done perfectly well, all those things are valid, then only the state will be updated into the block. So as you can see, like the sender balance is updated to Y minus amount. And the receiver is Z plus amount now. Same is with the case of smart contracts. So here the difference is like we have in the virtual machine, it loads the code and the state, and it executes the code and checks the rules, and followed by it generates the new state of the transaction. So first it tries to load the state and the code. What is the code associated with the smart contract? So we have the smart contract code here, and the state is like state 1 is equal to true, and state 2 is 0. Now the input is given to the state, so where like the contract and value contract, like for which contract you wanted to perform this operation, and what is the new value. So if the state is valid because of the virtual machine, you know, try to process all those information. So this updates the information. This updates the states. So like state 1 equals to false, and the state 2 is equal to value into 3. Now the code of this smart contract will remain always the same, but the state transition happens. Only the state changes would be happening. Now here is the one of the example of the smart contract. Like this is one of the example of smart contract that's been there. Now let's say for an example, this smart contract is handling many of those cryptocurrencies. It's written in high level language. This is the written in Solidity language, and it's been executed by the Ethereum virtual machine where it is being feeded. And usually, no patching after release. Like you cannot patch or you cannot change the code after the contract is deployed. So what can go wrong when the program handles billions of worth of cryptocurrencies? Let's just give you the example here. So here, there is this Remix. So Remix is one of the browser provided by Ethereum that's in full-fledgedly is a blockchain itself running in the browser. So what we have here is we have this same example code that we have shown. So you can deploy that contract here, and you can check what is the state. So if I'm clicking on this available balance, that is saying that current state, the current amount is 0. If I am depositing 100, so that should say, okay, 100, because you have deposited 100 amount of something, so the current state is 100. Now if I click on again to deposit, okay, I have deposited 100 more, so it should say 200. Now if I say, okay, I wanted to deposit third time more, 100. Now it should say 300. But as you can see, it has shown 44. That's the one of the example of integer buffer flow attack or integer overflow attack. So that's there are many sort of other problems as well. This is one of the examples we have shown. So what could go wrong? Like if your smart contract is not handling all those bugs and vulnerabilities in your contract, so here is the result. Like in 2018 itself, more than $1 billion worth of crypto got hacked from the smart contract of Ethereum itself. We are not talking about other hacks. So how the system is growing, like in terms of growth of the decentralized ecosystem, in terms of Ethereum itself, if we talk about, like in January 2016, it was like only 45 million worth of crypto was there. In January 2017, we see some improvement, like in it was 318 million. Then in January 2018, it suddenly jumped up to $6.5 billion, and now like in May 2018, it's more than like $6.8 billion. This is only we are talking about Ethereum ecosystem, only the Ethereum smart contracts. There are alternative solutions, alternative blockchains as well. Those are different blockchains. Maybe in future, many of those blockchains are running. Many of those blockchain in future we would be seeing like. More in terms of cryptocurrencies and amount will be stored onto those blockchains. So the real business, those are running on top of those smart contract is valued about $552 million of dollars. That's worth of crypto is logged. Now, I would like to go through the different hacks that has been happened. Like this is the one of the parity multisig hack. So multisig is like you have a contract, you multiple parties you can actually sign onto that transaction onto that contract. So it's not only the single person, it requires a multiple party to sign the transaction, then only the transaction happens. So the problem was like in multisig, the parity multisig bug, it was like only owner can withdraw ethers. But some attacker actually figured out that it is possible to change the owner as well. If I change the owner, I could own all those crypto assets that this particular contract has. This particular attack used it's been used by attacker, and more than 150,000 ether worth of ethers have been stolen from the contracts in July 2017 itself. This is another example that I wanted to talk about, DAO bug. So this contract is holding some funds. So this call can be exploited. So using this exploit, the attacker were able to steal more than 3.6 million worth of ether in June 2016 itself. So let's just look into the deeper of this problem. So here on the left side is the victim. On the right side is the attacker contract. Attacker has created their own contract and attacked onto the victim's contract. So what it does is, the attacker calls this method, attack method on his contract. This calls the victim's withdraw function, and this again goes back to the this function. So this function is again, if you're seeing that this is again calling back to the withdrawal, this will again go to the here, and from here at this point, it will again go back and call the withdrawal. So this is like happening more than 10 times. So at least 10 ether he was able to steal from this victim's contract. This is one of the examples that we have shown. So this is not the, these are the only two cases that we have discussed. These are not the only cases those are possible. There could be many more cases, many more hacks, those are happening, and those are possible. So one is like unexpected ether flows. So insecure coding, like you are not preventing your contracts from proper authorizations. Then use of unsafe inputs. So if you're providing some non-secure inputs, reentrancy method calls, as we have seen, like it was possible for reentrancy from a different multiple contracts, and manipulating ether flows via transaction or reordering. So the blockchains are slow. If you are able to manipulate the transaction orders, so you can actually change the behavior of the contract, and there are many more. So in terms of a lifeline of the smart contracts, like first we have the development phase, then we do the testing and the code auditing, then we have the post development. So the problem is that the development side is like writing secure contract is very hard, and at this stage is like auditing, and the during the audits, the manual mistakes could be missed, and the most anomalies are invisible into the post deployment. So what is our solution? We have this automated tools to certify the correctness of the contract. Then we have the professional auditing tools. Then for this stage, we have the monitoring tools to track the contract health after it deploys. So how do we know that the smart contract is secure that we have developed? So for that, we have two products that is completely available online that you can use. For Ethereum, we have a Securify. For Hyperledger chain code, we have a chain code scanner. So the Securify is already been received the grants from Ethereum Foundation itself. And it's just like in your computer, you have a virus scanner to find out the viruses. The same with the case of the smart contract. So it looks like this, like if you provide your contracts into the Securify, it will line by line provide you all this information, like what are the problems there in your contract. Now we have this, do the professional audits. Like we have the specification of the contract, like what you have wanted to write, and we have the contract. So once we receive that, how do we ensure that the whatever the specification that you have wrote is matching to the contract? So that's always a question mark. So what we do is we receive both of the things, and on our platform we have the security scanner, formal verification tools, AI-based testing, and the human inspection at the last. And after all those steps, we generate our audit report. More than 30,000 contracts we have certified with all our tools and everything, and more than 300 million crypto we have secured as of now. This is the Securify under the hood. So you have the first Securify, the EVM bytecodes. It decompiles to the Securify intermediate representation. Then it creates this Securify semantic representation. And then finally, based upon the patterns of the issues, it generates the report. You can go and check this on securify.ch website, and you can use it. It's open source and available online. Then we have the automated formal verification tool with that we call Vorex. So you have a smart contract that you have developed, and you have in your specification document, you says that, okay, my investor can claim refunds only if the sum of deposits never exceeds 10,000 Ether. So what you do, we have our own language, that is the formal property language, that you can use that and write those properties into this form. Any developer can learn this new language within few hours. So once you have this property written into the one of our language, then you can provide both of these to the Vorex, and it will give you that is this property verified or not verified. And it can do this up to the every depth of the level. Like it can prove the absence of any vulnerabilities if there is any. Then we have the security monitoring. So what happens after the deployment? Like once you deploy your contract on the blockchain, you may not be, you know, would be looking into the different things like what is happening under the hood. So for that, we have a tool, the security monitoring tool, like the public dashboard. It provides the public dashboard, private dashboard, and the alerting. So public dashboard is for your customers that they can see what is the health of your contract. The private dashboard is for you. And whenever something wrong happens, it will alert you. So further, for an example, we have this beauty token. Like there was a hack in beauty token in 2018. So if you see that this is the bar that would keep on checking for the underflows or the overflows. Here you can see that there was an overflow. Then the high value transfer, like if there is any high value transfer is happening onto the contract, those you can see, and if the contract is paused. So if you can see that when the underflow or the overflow happened, the high value transfer was happening. And at the same time, the team, those who are working, they actually pause the contract. So the products and the services. So we have the formal smart contract audits, like the security analysis by the Chain Security Audit Platform. Then we have the formalization of the custom requirements for our client. Then we do the private and the we generate the private and the public reports. Then we do also provide the premium consulting. We recently we have been working with one of the blockchain. We are auditing that blockchain, and we have tie up with the enterprise clients like the major Swiss banks. And we are doing this all this work in collaboration with ICE Center at Zurich. So ICE Center is interdisciplinary research center. That is the number one computer science department in Europe, and they are doing this in the area of security, they are doing multiple research. They are also the iCenter, our chain security is one of the spin-off company from iCenter, and these are the products. And the we have also partnered with Ethereum Foundation, Web3 Foundation, as well as Amazon. So that is what my talk is about. And we have our own newsletters. So we would be covering into the those newsletters, we would be covering what are the different security issues and security vulnerabilities has been found, and the solutions to those newsletter, those information will be provided into those newsletters. And if you want to contact us, you can go to our website, chainsecurity.com. You can also contact us by mail, contact@chainsecurity.com, and you can follow us on Twitter as well. Okay, thank you. Do we have the time for questions? Sorry? Do we have the time for questions?
Actually, we are running a little ahead of schedule, so we actually have 7 minutes. Does anyone have a question about smart contracts, data security, maybe something about your business you've run into? That's a big question mark for you. Sure, if you can introduce yourself.
Hey, Suresh from TrustWorks. I understand that you primarily covered the public blockchains and not the private ones. So, since we have time, can you throw some light on what is the security things that we should look out for, especially people who are working in the private blockchain?
Yeah, for the private blockchain, like as we said, we have one of the product called Chain Scanner, that is for Hyperledger chain code. But the thing is like. What we have seen is, like in terms of those contracts and those blockchains are private already, so the security vulnerability like happening all those things and vulnerabilities and attacks, the level of those attacks would be minimized because of the private blockchains. But on public blockchain, it's way more like anybody can see your code, anything, he can do anything from wherever part of the world. You cannot save it.
I actually have a question for you.
Sure.
How did you all discover the ETH vulnerability? How can you just give us like the brief story of how that went down? Because I don't think I saw that in the news articles, and I'm really curious.
Yeah,
how
absolutely.
Would you go
that's
about
a
finding
very good
something?
Question. Yeah, that's a very good question, because most of the people think that, okay, you have been knowing about those things, and at the last hour, you actually published that this is the problem. But the problem was that every biweekly, we have an internal lunch and learn session. Like each team member, whosoever wants, he can actually submit his talk or what's new is coming and what not, or what everybody would like to learn, all of those things. So for that, like we had a session from our CTO, like he had planned for whatever the new EIPs, like in Ethereum proposals will be proposed into the new hard fork. So he created those presentations. And he was showing it to us, and we were listening to him, and it was like, what is this? What you're talking about here, this seems to be something fishy here. Let's just look into that deeper. Then when we started looking into that deeper, then we found that all those things, and we confirmed all those things. Yes, it is possible that this is a kind of vulnerability. And then we actually proposed this. We did it with the responsible disclosure to Ethereum, via the bug bounty program. And then they reply, okay, this is one of the problem that we also accept, and we are going to delay it. But it was not, we were even thinking that it would not be, they would not be delaying the hard fork. We were not aware about all those things. It was only when they said, okay, we are doing it to safeguard. And after that, in February, it got applied again. And that proposal was removed, completely removed.
Hi, I'm Piyush from Team Abstract. So some of the applications running on Ethereum require some sort of randomization. And as it is difficult to generate a random number inside a smart contract, most people in the community recommend to use an Oracle, which then depends on a callback function, which opens the contract to a lot of vulnerabilities. So do you have any advice on best practices regarding randomization inside a smart contract? Because on all the applications that I've been working on, most of them require some sort of randomization.
Absolutely, that's a very good question. Like In Ethereum smart contract, there is no way as of now. People have been trying with the different things. Like they were also trying with the block number or block hash of a future block. But that is also not completely safe. So it's still like that's the you can say the drawback of the Ethereum smart contract and the Solidity language itself. You can say, but as of now we are dependent upon Oracle only. So there is no other option as of now, but maybe in future they will introduce something to do to cater to this problem. But it's still like, that's the problem.
Does anyone else have a question?
Okay, my name is Abhishek.
So
I just wanted to know, like, since we just came across that smart contract code cannot be modified once it has been deployed. So like, once we run into these issues, so then how do we upgrade the smart contract without impacting the business operations?
Okay, so as I shown you one of the example, like there was the Parity wallet bug. So the main thing is like once you deploy a contract, you cannot change the code of the contract. Its states can be changed. So if you see that the Parity wallet bug that I have shown, the bug was like, there were more than 500, Ethereum wallets of the Parity wallet has been deployed, and many of those companies were keeping their, ICO raised funds into that. So the hack was, like, attacker first, attacked onto the one contract, steal all the funds. Then he attacked on the second contract, steal all the funds. Then he attacked on the third contract, steal all the funds. The moment it happened, all those white hat hackers, those were there into the community. What they did is, they hacked all those rest of the other contracts with using the same way, using the same attack. So there is no possibility at all after deployment that you can modify the code, right? So, but there has been some proposals like you can create your upgradable contracts. But the problem is, if you are talking about decentralization, then decentralization and the law and the trust only comes when the law is, still as it is. If it is changeable, then it would be a centralized system again. Right? So you can write some upgradable smart contracts, but in Ethereum and in Solidity, it doesn't provide you the direct way to write your upgradable contracts. It's only using some hacks you can actually do those things. But it's not directly built into the system. Yeah, you can switch off, you can pause the contract and all those things that you can do, you can migrate, but all those things you have to plan in advance. Like, how would I do it, this thing? Let's say you are planning to do some migration. Most of our client, we ask them. Like, in case of like Paxos, we have audited. In case of that, like we ask them initially, like, what is your plan? Would you be migrating to another contract or doing the upgrades? They said yes. So then we also make sure that, okay, they are talking about the legitimate things and they would be able to upgrade to the new contract easily. If you're not planning those things, then definitely you are in hell. Like, it's not at all possible.
Okay, we have one last question here.
So up till now, Suresh, hi, this is Nilesh here. Up till now, we were talking about the security, public or private, at the code level, at the configuration level. So my question is on the underlying infrastructure. So EVM is there. Now, so there is a subset of question that is there any specification which is different to the normal virtual machines like Hyper-V or VMware? So is there any specific which we need to take into the consideration when
in terms of security?
In terms of security, yes.
Yeah, the thing is like both like Hyperledger or Ethereum, first of all, those are differently created for the different purposes. And the problem, like as we said, the problem that we have figured out, the reentrancy issue that we have figured out and raised to the Ethereum Foundation in January, it was a problem with virtual machine. It was not a problem with contracts. DAO attack, Parity attack, that we can say it was a problem of contracts. But what if the virtual machine is not secure enough to do all those things? So that was the problem that we have figured out, and that was on that level of the virtual machine level.
So how did you figure out? I mean, the same way we conduct the VAPT for different.
Sorry, same way?
The vulnerability assessment and penetration testing, what we do for other virtual machines
yeah.
as part of the underlying infrastructure, any of the entity, have you done the same, I mean, you followed the same process, or do we have something specific for the EVMs?
The tools that we have, all those tools are for smart contracts and all those things, that is our core focus. And the VM part was specifically like, it was only the discussion that we were having, like what is the change the people are actually doing, the new improvements. At that point, it was over the manual inspection, we figured it out. We don't have as such any things. But the ICE center that I talk about, we have created one of the product that actually checks the smart contract along with the virtual machine as well. And we have also been supported this one from Ethereum Foundation.
And you have your own proprietary security monitoring tools also, which monitors 24/7.
Securify is open source, completely open source.
Okay, but that's on the public. I'm talking about on private side.
Yeah.
Let's say if I'm using blockchain, so in my organization, let's say if I'm using Ripple, for example, the backbone, do I need to procure a separate tool, or can I monitor through my own security incident and event management tool, which I have positioned for my infrastructure?
I think you can, if you're, for an example, Negios actually use the same kind of stuff. If you can write a plugin for the Negios, then definitely you can use that stuff.
So, but Negios is a, like, it's very basic. If you talk about the enterprise.
Yeah, absolutely. Like for the enterprise as well, there would be, I don't know which enterprise version of the monitoring tool you are using. If they are supporting those APIs, then definitely, for an example, the Google have started, providing this BigQuery for Ethereum blockchain. Whatever the data is there into the Ethereum blockchain, you can just write in the SQL query and fetch those data, just like that.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Please give a warm thank you to Mr. Dechendra Chatoda. And of course, if you have questions, you can just hire Chain Security, So thank you so much for your time. We know it's valuable. And we'll see, where is the next $50 million ETH hole? Hopefully there isn't one. Okay, so for the next panel, we're gonna dive a little deeper. Since we have so many questions, we wanna make sure that we can really get in a little deeper. So for the next panel, I'm gonna call up our moderator, Mr. Anirudh with Acyclic Labs, and he will introduce our next panel.
Thank you, Jessica. So for our next panel, we have, first and foremost, Amol from Intel. So he's a senior security architect and head of engineering of blockchain program office at Intel India, and he's also the head of Hyperledger India. So please welcome Amol. Let's have a seat according to the second one. Next, we have Nilesh. Nilesh, who founded Indium Network, is with ClearText right now, and has been a core developer and contributor to BigchainDB and Core Ethereum. And finally, we have Jitendra again. Hello, Jitendra. He's again a blockchain security engineer with Chain Security and a smart contracts auditor. Welcome, guys. It's great to have you here. It's from different flavors of blockchain space and security part that we have here. So just to get started, what does security mean to each of you in the blockchain space specifically? Yeah, anyone can go first.
Okay, so Intel mainly focuses on hardware, as you know. So hardware is the bedrock of all our security, and we provide a number of security hooks in the hardware, whether it is crypto acceleration, whether it's hardware random number generator, someone asked that question. We also have Intel Software Guard Extensions, SGX, which is a trusted execution environment. In fact, we have two trusted execution environments on every single Intel platform. So security is the bedrock of hardware is the bedrock of all security for Intel. Now, having said that, we also are very deeply involved in the blockchain space in terms of standards definitions, in terms of developing ledger software, etc. So in standards definition, we are working with the Enterprise Ethereum Alliance to define the Trusted Compute API, which is an off-chain smart contract execution engine based on SGX. And we've done a number of things in the Hyperledger space. We're contributing to Hyperledger Ursa. Sawtooth has a consensus mechanism called POET, which is based on Intel SGX, which enhances the security of the blockchain. And one of the things that we like to tell everyone that one of the myths that we like to bust is when people think blockchain is secure, there are a number of different things that come with security. And unfortunately, security has been conflated with confidentiality, and blockchain does not provide confidentiality. It provides the other two pillars of security, which is integrity and availability. And so that is one of the very first conversations we end up having with a lot of folks, that security in a blockchain does not necessarily mean confidentiality.
Right, Nilesh?
Okay, hi. So at a very high level, the way I think about security is it comes from the idea of fairness, the idea of rights, and security, especially the technology security, is a way which removes the need for us to go to the courts to get our rights enforced. So cryptography gives you protection. It's a technical protection rather than a legal protection. And you can always have your systems building around legal protection, but cryptography brings the technical protection around your rights. So that's a very high level construct. Now you can think about different sorts of right? I have a right to know something. I have the right to be forgotten about something. I have the right to own something, possess something. I have the right to, let's say, communicate something. All these rights, when you define to a domain, then you can start bringing in the technology protection and the legal protection. So, of course, I think deeply more about the technical side. So I think about cryptography and those are the aspects I'll cover more. But yeah, that's what security means to me at a high level.
Great.
Yeah, so in terms of security, what I think is like, as we are into the smart contract and the blockchain space, we are not into the core level of space. So if I talk about the security and that thing is like it all depends upon what is your security model that you wanted to implement. So whether you have like some different roles in your system. So what could go wrong if a role is malfunctioning, or if there is a way to hack to that particular role? So the security is a very bigger term. But if we talk about like in a specific terms, so security is at the what is the privileges to be there under the contract, that's on the smart contract level, and how much funds and all those things like the crypto assets and Ethereum, those are there present on those contract, and what are your security goals are there for your smart contract? Like there is a boundary, like under those boundary, your crypto fund should be moving. That is your specification says. If it is possible to take those Ethereum out of those boundaries, then there is a security problem. So security is very big, but you have to define the boundaries. Like what are your boundaries are there? Under those boundaries, if that is there, that is perfectly all right. You are completely secure. So that is that's on the smart contract level. Like on the blockchain level, as we have figured out the reentrancy bug. So on the blockchain level, the same thing, same applies. Like what is there that you wanted to protect into the smart contract while it is executing on the EVM level? So that was the problem that we figured out. Like it was like there was a problem into the VM level that allowed an attacker to a non-attackable contract previously been deployed. So that was the thing.
All right, cool. That's great. So one very valid point that Amol raised was the confidentiality in blockchain. What aspects of security on data locking that blockchain actually cannot solve Let's go from there. What is your thoughts, Jitendra, on that, and how can that aspects be covered, if at all, via other tools or mechanisms?
So in terms of data logging?
Yeah, I mean, the other aspect of security, instead of the confidentiality part and confidentiality in blockchain, is it really viable, or if not?
So in terms of the confidentiality, if we talk about the public blockchains only, so the confidentiality is completely not there. And if we talk about the private blockchains, yeah, there are some confidentiality is there. But on Ethereum blockchain, you have to do some sort of confidential transaction. So for that, you have a different commit and reveal kind of schemes and all those things. So if you want to lock some secure data on the Ethereum blockchain, it's not very possible to do that thing, but you have to do some other ways around it. But in case of private blockchain, definitely it is possible.
That's interesting. Nilesh, Indium Network is a public blockchain. Do you think it's possible to actually have that model of securing a user's data and still use a public blockchain? If yes, what can be that model?
So initially I was in a camp that it's not really possible, but then I started learning about zero knowledge proofs, and I used to contribute to BigchainDB, and they've been working along with the broader community to bring out a standard called crypto conditions. Now, crypto condition is a completely blockchain agnostic way of encoding the conditions that have to be made before a transfer can happen, right? So you can have an asset in public, somewhere in public, but you can put some conditions attached. Now, conditions can be either of various kinds. You can have time lock, you can have hash lock, you can have multi-signature requirement that, okay, 3 out of 5 parties must sign this before this transfer can happen. So crypto conditions is a standard, is a JSON document that you attach, and it's up to the network to enforce those security. But it's really possible, and we are seeing some really advanced applications of, let's say, zero knowledge proofs to build, let's say, secret voting systems on public blockchain. So yeah, I wouldn't go as far as to say that it's not possible on public blockchain anymore.
Wow. Coming from zero knowledge proof, on the enterprise level also, zero knowledge proof has shown considerable amount of usage, right? Even integrations with the private blockchains. Can you comment on that, on how you guys using it?
So it's still an area of research, right? It's not been deployed. Having said that, Hyperledger recently approved a project called Hyperledger Ursa, which is meant to be a common crypto library for all blockchains, not just enterprise blockchains. And zero knowledge proofs are one of the active areas of code contributions into that. So my expectation is by the time it reaches to 1.0, we will have some code in there, some assets in there that will help with the zero knowledge proof deployment in enterprise and hopefully eventually in the public blockchain space.
Is this a public blockchain or is an open source project that anybody can contribute, or is just owned by Intel as of now?
So Intel owns nothing. Everything is open source, right? So as far as Intel's contribution to the blockchain software stack, there was a project in 2014 inside Intel Labs called Sawtooth Lake. In 2016, we contributed that to Hyperledger, and since then it's become Hyperledger Sawtooth. Intel doesn't own anything, and in fact, nothing in Hyperledger is owned by a single company. It is completely open source. Hyperledger keeps adding new projects, new top-level projects for addressing various different aspects of blockchain, and Hyperledger Ursa is one that just got approved last December, and it's completely open source. Anyone can download the code, anyone can contribute to it. You don't need to have any kind of membership to Hyperledger for that.
And it's actually a new kind of age that we are living in, because Hyperledger is being maintained by the Linux Foundation. And there's a lot of enterprises who are actually coming up with open source or contributing to open source projects than like decades before of how it went. But again, from the enterprise side, would you guys still be ready or viable to use a public blockchain with, let's say, zero knowledge proof or the kind of crypto conditions that BigchainDB provides?
See, I think we have to step back and take a big picture look at what it is that we are trying to accomplish, right? It depends on what your use case is. What are your requirements? Who's going to use it? What are your security requirements and objectives? And based on that, you should make a selection of what is the right ledger to use, right? Let's not, my advice to everyone is, let's not first decide on whether we want to do public or private or whatever, and then try to solve all the problems that come along with it. Let's go the other way. Let's figure out what is the problem we want to solve and then fit the tools to match the problem.
That's a very valid advice. Thank you, Amol. Okay, coming from the other side.
On that note, also this whole public-private dimension is just one dimension. You have other dimensions, whether the chain is permissionless or permissioned. So it's possible to have public and permissioned blockchains. It's possible to have sort of private chains which are sort of decentralized in a way, which is good enough.
Yeah.
So that's just one dimension. You should be looking at every dimension and then pick what is best for your problem.
Definitely, like you said, it's all based on the use cases that you have to go with. All right. So that was one aspect from the infrastructure side. Let's go a bit high level towards smart contracts and the auditing of smart contracts, because that's the layer where the user interact to get their data into the blockchain, right? So how do you go about auditing a smart contract or making sure that it's secured? Do you outsource your thing to a security company? Do you do it yourself, or have a team of people and have a sort of like a list of checks that you let it pass through? You think
so? So in terms of auditing, like we don't go for any other services or any other company to do the further audits and all those things. All those tools that we have is inbuilt, like we have built in those tools for our company, and for on the online also, like this, as I said, like Securify is completely open source and it's available online. The chain code scanner is also available online, that anybody can use it. So these tools we use, but the process that we follow is, first we get the specification of the from the client and their code, and then we check that it actually compiles, and do they have created all those test cases? Do they have the proper coverage of their code? That gives us some sort of a certification, like what client has actually provided all these things, and does it follow the standard guidelines and all those things or not. Then we move forward, and we have an automated process, like whenever any client gives us their project, we put this in our different tools, and they generate the output. Maybe it's a false positive or the true positive. So based on that, then we verify all those issues from the smart contract. And so this is how the process is. And then we generate the internal audit report that is private to the client. Then client can say, okay, this is not a valid case because the specification was missing. So they say at that time, like, okay, some specification was not correct. So they rewrite the specification to make it correct, and then we figure it out, okay, this is perfectly all right. Then later we send them the public report.
Interesting. So that's how a smart contract is actually audited the entire process. From the BigchainDB side, they came up with something called IPDV, and there was some security flaws that they came up with. Could you shed some light on that and why the project got shut down in January 17?
So IPDV was not shut down due to security flaws. IPDV essentially is a BigchainDB cluster. So it's a MongoDB with a Python service in front, which sort of enforces blockchain characteristics.
Okay, let me rephrase that. Not exactly security flaws, but since we are on the data subject, on the
So Indium network happens to be Ethereum compatible, so everything that applies to Ethereum also applies to Indium. And our community's approach for security auditing of contracts has been to use the standard contracts, right? Try not to write custom code. So Solidity, in my opinion, has been a bit too powerful, right? Too low level, you could say, right? We would need higher level constructs. And I saw that in your presentation.
Yeah, absolutely.
So the DSL,
yeah,
which lets you enforce conditions. I think we will need a language that directly or explicitly calls out the rights and protections which are necessary, and then your compiler can translate that to a working correct code. I think we'll need to move to that. Solidity is just too powerful, which means it's too easy to make mistakes.
That's interesting. We were just discussing on the types of things that a smart contract would require from the infrastructure level to make it more secure. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Sure. So the infrastructure or the hardware has a number of hooks that are provided, and most of these are absolutely free to a user to use. Right. I'll just talk about one thing, Intel SGX. This is a trusted execution environment that comes inbuilt into every single Intel processor that's shipped for the last 5 years. There are billions and billions of these devices out there, and using that is completely free, right? So use those, make use of those for your smart contracts or for your clients as well. Or if you're writing a wallet, make sure you use all the crypto and security hooks that are provided on the hardware to enhance your security and make yourself less vulnerable. Because no matter how much you try to secure your code, there are always some attack vectors that might be possible in the OS, in the VM, who knows where. So there are a number of facilities available for developers, for auditors to use to just raise the bar and make it more difficult for an attacker to do some malicious stuff.
Awesome. Now, I would just like to ask a simple question, which is of my personal interest as well, and also a sensitive topic in India, Aadhaar, right? If at all you were to redesign the structure, and would blockchain be a viable option for it? Because it all it has to do with is locking down data, that which is the topic of our panel discussion today. What do you think would be a viable architecture, and if at all, if it's on blockchain? If not, what can it be on? We can start with Jitendra.
So in terms of, you know, Aadhaar is like, first of all, it's a very big like implementation of in India is completely very big. And if we were to redesign that one, like first of all, with the Aadhaar that we have seen, like the privacy of the data and all those things were not there. So the first and foremost requirement must be that whatever data I wanted to, you know, send it to someone else or some party. So there has to be some selective sharing, like which part of data from my Aadhaar card I wanted to send it to someone else. It shouldn't be lying on the government system. It should be in my hand. Whenever I sign with my thumb impression or anything like that, then only it should be shared. So this is what I think, like that can go beyond.
Cool. So in that case, having a permissionless public blockchain wouldn't really be a viable situation to put down Aadhaar data, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Like public blockchain are not that much, I would say.
All right, cool. Nilesh, your opinions?
So Aadhaar is an authentication system. Any authentication system has two failure modes. One is false positive. So somebody got authenticated even though he was not supposed to be. So that's fraud. And you have false negatives. So I was supposed to be authenticated, I am the genuine person, but I was declined. So that's exclusion. And any auth system will try to minimize the combination of false positive and false negative, right? Now, they'll have to make trade-offs. If you try to reduce fraud, you will increase exclusion. If you try to reduce exclusion, you will increase fraud. That's the nature of the authentication system. Now, you can only control this by only attempting small set of a problem. And the problem with Aadhaar, in my opinion, has been that it tries to do too much. It tries to solve the government's needs, it tries to solve the private sector's needs, and it tries to solve the citizens' needs. If you start with such a big scope, that leaves out very little room for traversing this trade-off. All right. Like, there's only so much that you can minimize.
Okay.
So because of the scope, I mean, the best approach for me would be to design a solution for a limited scope. And then you can optimize for that.
So basically, we break it down into different.
Yeah. So you build Aadhaar, one kind of Aadhaar for private sector usage, another kind for subsidies, another kind for citizens, let's say services.
Okay, that's a good opinion. Amol,
thank you for asking that question. This is a topic that's very close to my heart. So I helped in the Aadhaar registered device spec definition, and so I've I've had a chance to interact with the architects of Aadhaar, right? And in the era that it was designed, it was a good design because that was the technology that was available at that time. Unfortunately, it's a centralized database. And hopefully it is, the biometric credentials are protected in a good manner. The attacks that you see are in the usage of that, in the usage of those attestations, right? How do you get those attestations and what do you do with those? If we had to do that again, we would go, I would recommend going with a distributed architecture in the sense that go with something like a self-sovereign identity. You have your biometrics on your device with you. They're not in any central database, right? And that's what we've all been talking about. And then based on the type of request that comes to you, someone wants your fingerprint or someone wants to know your date of birth, and then you decide what you want to, how you want to release that, and you release an attestation that is verified by everyone. What you use the blockchain for is storing those requests, is storing those attestations, and not the actual biometrics themselves. And that's how you would design a viable, scalable, and more secure Aadhaar or any authentication system for the future. And in fact, if you go look at Hyperledger ND, that's very similar to what it's doing.
So on that front, I actually think the scope issue again becomes important. The reason biometrics are actually centralized in Aadhaar because it was designed as a subsidy mechanism, and we can't expect poor people to own smartphones.
Absolutely.
So again, if you limit the scope to, let's say, something that covers anybody who doesn't have a smartphone, then you come up with a different architecture.
Yeah.
And when you expand it to, let's say, KYC for mutual fund investment, of course you can expect the user to have a smartphone in that case, in which case you can actually leverage the architecture that you're talking about.
I think there has to be some basic assumptions on the design architecture. And this is actually a very basic basic analogy that you can use when you're designing your NIST ID authentication system. I think we have a couple of more minutes, so we can take a few questions. 1 minute. Okay. We can take a few questions. No? Okay. All right. You can catch our speakers offline. And thank you, panelists. Thank you, Amol, Nilesh, and Jitendra, for your time and enlightening us with locking down data and security.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anirudh, Amol, Nilesh, and Jitendra. That was quite a session. Some really insightful and tech-heavy conversation we had. Now, with pleasure, I introduce one of our key advisors, Dr. Ajay Garg, from the Ministry of Electronics and IT. He's the HOD for Startup Innovation, International Cooperation, and IT and IT-enabled services. And sir, with that, I'll please like to call you on the stage. Thank you.
Morning, friends. Thank you, Akshay. Thank you, Blockchain India. I don't know what's the reason for calling it blockchain rather than blockchain. So I'm not I'm no more a techie, so I can't talk about technologies and how does blockchain work, but I'll give you a perspective why we are talking of all this, why such a big crowd is here. So in that, I'll start with the context. India is known to be an IT services hub or a services industry. Bangalore happens to be the capital of this. we have a market of around $200 billion on the services front, with an exports of around $140 billion, and that too mainly to the West. A fairly secured space, which considered to be a fairly secured space till the till 2014 or 15. At the same time, with the emergence of Flipkarts and the Snap deals in 2008-9, India started emerging as an important destination to startups. The first few years on the startup journey was around the business innovation side, and we first five, six years saw a lot of e-commerce, lot of services oriented startups emerging, mainly played the investment game rather than a game of entrepreneurship around it. And that was the story till the time that this bubble busted in the same year around 2014. And then the real tech startup journey started emerging in India. Again, for this, Bangalore happens to be the capital. So anything and everything that has to do with IT or computers starts with Bangalore. And I hope that it doesn't end with Bangalore. And you people are actually able to diversify and contribute it and equitably distribute it around the country. Now on the services front, what are the challenges that we are facing in since 2014 or in the last 4 or 5 years? There are three basic challenges that the services industry will face and will and is facing. The first and the foremost is the emergence of new technologies, which has the potential that the human power is taken over by the machines, and where the issues of transfer of services to an offshore destination, which includes issues like security, transparency, authenticity, and all that, goes off when machine takes over human. So that's the first challenge to the outsourcing industry. The second challenge is, as my earlier speaker was talking about, is data. Everyone is talking about data to be the new oil. And when everyone is talking about the huge value around oil, so if there are concerns that are growing around the world on cross-border data flows. And there are more and more restrictions that will are coming and will be coming in near future on how data flows from one border to other. So cross-border services industry will face a challenge due to these challenges that data is. So there has to be a reasonable settlement that has to come to the world that how does cross-border data flow regimes are administered globally. And but the unfortunate part is that all international regulations which involve around 180 countries have their own gestation period of inclusions, and by that time the services industry will face real challenges in getting data on which a services industry is based around. The third thing comes is around the issue of whether if AIs and the blockchains and such technologies are taking over the old set of rules that the services industry was being driven by, whether India has the requisite manpower to serve the this new age regime or not, whether the large pool of IT engineers, or which we have been our core strength in driving the IT industry,
has actually upskilled themselves or have evolved themselves to take the challenges of this new tech world? That is the third basic question that needs to be addressed. And all these three things actually put a big question mark on the whole IT industry. But considering that IT is the biggest white-collar job provider in the country, providing more than 4.1 million good quality jobs to our young professionals or young citizens, then we cannot shelve away from the responsibility that, look, IT is there for the next few years and something else will take over and the world will survive, world survives. But let's understand why IT is important, because IT is the has made us grow into a quality country where quality of life has become important, has resulted in major infrastructures of big cities evolving, or infrastructure disasters like Bangalore evolving, because there were people who were ready to spend money and create jobs for many other people. So IT becomes important in the sense that it is a very good quality job providing sector that is there, and we need to keep it. So we need to think about how do we change and strategize ourselves to this changing paradigm of IT. The second most important thing is that why these emerging techs have become important is that, for a simple reason, that with the emergence of these emerging sectors like blockchains and AIs, IT from being a vertical and a silo industry in itself is now a horizontal, which will drive productivity in all sectors of economy, whether it's agriculture, infrastructure, transport, medical, all sectors. The future growth in all these sectors will come from what is the digital story around these sectors. So IT has itself now become a basic enabler for the whole national economy to be driven in future. And here comes the very critical role which IT plays in the future. Now the challenges for India to have is that we need to grow from a services to a tech or a product nation. So whether the same set of companies which were highly successful will actually revolve themselves, recreate themselves, re-revolutionize themselves, and become the leaders in this changing paradigm, or we need to have a fresh set of companies thinking more innovatively and coming up with solutions that drives and creates the next generation's forces or Wipros. That is the thing that we need to think. And if we go by basic management principles, it's difficult for difficult or challenging for companies to revolve themselves. There have been very few success stories globally. But I think that we need to actually work with these young entrepreneurs and help them, handhold them to become the next generation large IT companies. In this context, there is a role that is very important for all existing players that need to actually come together and think of a solution which actually addresses all these three. The role of government is paramount. The role of academia and the research is very important. And the role of existing tech companies to drive this new set of entrepreneurs is also equally important. Because these new set of entrepreneurs, if at all they have to recreate themselves, will actually help them recreate themselves. So these three players, if they come together, support the next generation entrepreneurship, we believe that will be the case that will actually solve the challenging regime or the challenging age for IT, which is there for us. So let me start off with what we have done. So we always believed in the services sector. We believed that ITIS services are important. We came up with a system where the products and the services were taxed as a single entity at 18%. We never, as a government, differentiated in products and services. So what it happened is there was only one thing that emerged was the services sector. And Indian product space is limited to $2.1 billion. And that's the limited space that we have. Even though we have around 1,000 tech R&D centers of the globe based out of India, some of the major solutions to the tech giants of the world coming out from the Indian shores flowing, but the IP belongs to them. It doesn't belong to us. And so we came up with a national policy on software products on 28th of February. After a lot of discussion and a lot of challenging times that I faced, because I was part of the drafting team, unfortunately, because the services industry was not ready to give away its space. But okay, we came up with a national policy on software products where we talked about $100 billion product industry by 2025. We talked about creating a whole holistic ecosystem of creating a million professionals who can handle these emerging techs and handle the product space, who are good at product design space and all these issues, where we are thinking of creating a 10,000 strong tech startup ecosystem, creating a cluster of places where we can have a focused approach towards emerging techs. We all know that the services capital of India is Bangalore, but no one of us will be knowing that the SaaS capital of India happens to be Chennai. No one notices that. No one considers that. We need to actually bring them up, create solutions, address their pain points to actually contribute significantly to the IT sector, significantly to the Indian economy. The second important thing is that how do we bring the academia, industry, and the government together to help the next generation entrepreneurs. They all are contributing to this space quite significantly, but as silos. There's a need that these three entities come together with the startup ecosystem to actually drive this space. As the Ministry of Electronics and IT, what we thought of is have sector-specific center of excellences mainly being driven by an industry champion, with industry, academia, and the research coming together and driving a sector-specific technology for a sector-specific cause through an entrepreneurship model and trying to solve the issue of market access for these startups by government being the first market. For this, what we did is we actually cleared our policies with regard to procurement. We provided a specific niche space for the startups on the government e-marketplace that happens to be the single entity for all procurement. And we try to enthuse the players together to actually come together, and the industry that is there will actually be partnering with them to provide them the market. Because today I think if you're sitting in Bangalore, you can't talk about investments in startups being the major issue. It's the first market or the market being the larger issue today. Investment's important, but market is more important. Because the moment someone is able to prove his technology in the first few markets, and that shows some sort of a tangibility and enthusiasm, the market comes by itself. And the future investments also flow in. Now, this is one thing. Now, when we are talking about that, these are all integrated. What in India? India is not like a place in the West where you have a billion or a $5 billion or a $10 billion to spend in creating a blockchain infrastructure. Then you create a $10 billion infrastructure. If you can't get money for a private space satellite to flow into the space, project in Bangalore, which was very important but failed because of the investments flowing in the crowdsourcing model. So it's difficult to think of such type of investment. It has to be a pooled resources that will work for India if we have to think of some tangible solution and some results that can flow in. So what we did is we tried to get, as a government, we tried to create our own accelerator called the Mighty Startup Hub, which we launched some few months back, where we are trying to bring all this incubation and the startup ecosystem space onto a single platform, interconnect them, pool the resources, and bring it to a single entity, and that flows the requirements for the startups as per the needs of a particular entrepreneur or startup. And this might be. So what I'll request you all to be part of that startup hub, start the journey. An idea is good, but it only works if it has the volumes. And the volumes comes from you, not from us. And you have to drive us in doing this. The third important thing what I will tell you is that the government does not no more works through bureaucracies. They've understood this one such thing that we cannot make a difference. It is you, the champions, who can make a difference, and we have to make you part of our stakeholder journey. So all these incubators, all these center of excellences, even the Mighty Startup Hub, what we have said is that the drivers will be the industry champions rather than the government. And that is one difference what I think will actually can make a difference if we have a serious, committed, and an honest approach to this. The last thing that I will touch upon is why blockchain, because this happens to be a conference on blockchain, why blockchain is important. If you are living in foremost important thing why blockchain is important is privacy and the ownership of data. In the today's world, what happens is the ownership of a data of a person who is provider is never there. It is the person on who has actually solved the data owns that data. If he's working on his mobile and giving some data across, it will be either the WhatsApp or the Google who will be actually owning that data rather than him. The blockchain has a capacity and the capability to actually come up with a new regime where the provider himself becomes the owner of the data. And if we consider data to be the oil and the monetization of the data, there should be a stake of the provider of the data also in that monetization journey. This is the biggest solution or the biggest problem that blockchain will solve in the future when everyone is talking about monetizing data and I should be a rightful stakeholder in that monetization journey. And that is one thing. The second foremost important thing on a blockchain is that the scale and the speed at which the solutions can be rolled out. we are always proud that we have actually been able to do Aadhaar in a very record time of say 6-7 years at a scale which is unimaginable in the world. Everyone, the country looks at it, and the whole world looks at us. We have enrolled around 1.23 billion people onto the Aadhaar. Someone talked about security and the breach, data breaches. In spite of all these challenges, a centralized database has been fairly secured in India. But yes, there are challenges to this. The blockchain solves this. Blockchain solves the speed at which such huge platform projects can be enrolled. And let's understand that we have moved from an era of from projects to programs to platforms. And the future digital journey will be all around platforms rather than programs. And they have to be an open API interconnected, and blockchain is the best solution to provide them. We are always proud of Bhoomi, the land digitalization project of Karnataka. And that was a very good example where technology was used. But I'm sure if the Karnataka government today conceptualizes a Bhoomi project for 2019, then they cannot ignore blockchain. If Ayushman Bharat has to be a success, where we have been able to enroll 50 crores or 500 million seekers, but are not sure whether we have the enough capacity to provide that a quality healthcare to such a huge number of insured people, or bringing a huge, some 300 million people who were never part of the formal healthcare system on board, then I think there's a need for digital space to flow in to provide the capacity to the healthcare to address the issues faced with Ayushman. And the foremost technology that will be important, I think, will be the blockchain. There is no network of healthcare services. There is no network of there is no network on the seeker space, or if a patient has to travel from one place to another and his data has to flow in a secured and privacy has to be respected, then the only provider can be blockchain. So blockchain, which started with a dirty name of a cryptocurrency, has the capacity to do all social goods. And that I believe that there's a huge opportunity that lies around blockchain, and there's a need for us to leverage. The need for us is bigger than what is the need for the West in terms of the blockchain. Because of the reason that we need digital in a huge way to address governance issues, to address the social transformation issues, and to address these things at a pace which has never been imagined by the West. Because in the social media world, a citizen has become restless, and he cannot tolerate an inefficient system at the same lethargic speed which we used to tolerate. Today's youngster is not ready to take a B-grade quality of life anymore, and he needs to actually evolve himself and come out. And technology has got a very important role in social transformation of India. And it's more important for India than it is for the West. So in that context, what I believe is that emerging technology in India has got a very important role to play, and has got not only an important role as a social subject, but it will be a big entrepreneurship opportunity in India. And we all should come together to make this journey happen. if the blockchain India has brought in some right players on board in this journey, then unofficially I provide him a helping hand that Government of India will be another partner in this journey to take the blockchain revolution to the next level. And I and we as Government of India are ready, thank you, to provide all necessary help so that blockchain solution for societal goods for next generation entrepreneurship is a reality in near future. Thank you, and I look forward to some more meaningful discussions on this.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ajay Garg, for being here. And I'm really happy to hear you mention data ownership, because I think I agree with you 100%. This is one of the biggest issues. So thank you so much for your time and being here. And we appreciate it so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. So we will save you from having so many questions, but definitely during the lunch break, if you would like, you can speak with the doctor. But for now, we're going to push on with our schedule. So I'd like to bring up our next speaker, Ms. Nyan Lakshmi. She's with Women Who Code, and she's a developer, and she participated in our hackathon the other day, and she's a leader in the space. So she's going to share with us a little bit about what does the landscape look like for diversity and innovation in blockchain tech. Thank you, Nyana.
Hi, everyone. So while the clicker comes, let me just introduce myself. So in the morning, I was quite happy because Jessica introduced me as the founder of Women Who Code, but I'm not, unfortunately. I'm Gyan Lakshmi, and I'm the leadership fellow for blockchain at Women Who Code, and I'm also working on my legal tech startup, which is kind of aimed to close the justice loop for sexual harassment at workplaces. So I'm leading the tech initiative for that. Today, I'm going to talk about a little bit about what is Women Who Code, what do we do, and how can everybody sitting in this room contribute to this community as such. So Women Who Code is a nonprofit started about 8 years ago. The headquarters is based out of US, but we have chapters across the globe. As you can see, our mission is to we want to inspire women to excel in technology careers. Today, we have come here to attend a conference which is based on blockchain. And you can just look around you in the room and see if you can find a woman sitting next to you. If you can't, in the near future, that's what we plan to do, in short. Our vision is a world where women are proportionally represented as technical leaders, VCs, founders, board members, and software engineers. So we want more and more women to not only be developers, but CTOs, CEOs, and whatnot. One of the things that we talk about, or why our community has been so successful, is because we follow a strict code of conduct wherein we encourage an inclusive mindset, an open mindset. So nobody should be judged on the basis of gender, race, color, or whatever. And in each of our meetups, in each of our events, we make sure that we inculcate an inclusive mindset. Women Who Code Worldwide, just wanted to put up this small slide. I'm sure you can see some India chapters here. There's one chapter in Bangalore, there's one in Chennai, there's one in Pune. There are two coming up in Hyderabad and Mumbai as we speak. So every industry is tech. As we all know that all of the industry today is moving towards technology, And as every industry moves towards technology, we want more and more women to come and participate in this technology revolution. This is just some small statistic that I pulled up because Jessica told me that she wanted my talk to be very statistic oriented, but I didn't really have to pull up this statistic because it's very evident that there is a strong lack of diversity in the tech industry as we see today. You can see, forget all of the other industries, just look at high tech. So at high tech, you can see that there are 72% of men and just the rest, 28% are women. So what do we do? So how does Women Who Code function, right? So what we try to do is we try to give access to resources to women across the globe, right? So we conduct regular meetups, we conduct online events, we get mentors to mentor women, we have technical conferences. So all of these apart, this year we have released 6 technical track communities because our community started realizing the value of working together, right? So just to maybe, you know, give you a short background on how I started, you know, really taking advantage of these communities. I started as a fresher in the tech world in 2012, and I started working with Oracle. And by 2014, I was pretty much ready to quit tech because I thought that I didn't belong there. And in 2015 is when I joined my second company, which was VMware. And I came to know about Women Who Code. Trust me, our first mini project that just some 3 women in a room was just a building a small web app using HTML and PHP. But we were so super excited because it was something new for us to learn. And post that is when I have been associated with Women Who Code for about 4 years now as a volunteer, as a leader, as a contributor, because I truly believe that diversity can bring a lot of changes to the way a company, a team functions. It can give you, you know what, sometimes I've seen that people have brainstormed different kind of architecture sitting in a room, and just having diverse opinion can ensure that, you know, your product's architecture is very well solidified from the scratch. So moving on to these deep technical learning communities, we started getting requests across the globe that people wanted to learn or deep dive into these technical topics, and not all of the in-person events are able to do that. So we created these 6 online technical tracks which were released this March, and I lead the blockchain track, which is an online global community. And that's Women Who Code Blockchain, a global community of blockchain enthusiasts with a motto to encourage more women to come into this technology. Why I say a global community of blockchain enthusiasts and not a global community of women? Because it's not sufficient to have just women in this community. It is important that everybody around them also works towards bringing this diversity. So this is the, I just want to put a screenshot of what we are doing, what the community is like. So we do online events, we have coding resources, people can get involved as volunteers. Our sponsors are Hired and Stellar, who are sponsoring the blockchain track this year. So what do we do at the blockchain community track? We have tech talks, workshops, tutorials, and trainings. Why I put this slide is actually to brag about myself, because this community was released in March and we are the only community that has done 10 plus online events so far. So you can imagine that there's a demand for this technology and there's a demand for women as well in this technology. So we have technical study and project groups. We do a lot of study groups over Slack. And we have a lot of people mentoring us who can come in, give us ideas, and you know, help women to work on these projects. We have interactive discussions with technical industry experts. We do interviews with experts, remote experts. So I've interviewed a couple of experts in Berlin, Australia, just to understand what is the blockchain perspective in their respective geographies. networking opportunities with track topic focus members. For example, I have got this opportunity to network with you, and I hope to take this forward and get my community members involved and, you know, introduced to some of you who might be willing to support this community. Product demos and pro tips, access to the latest coding resources, pop-up in-person track training events. So on request, we even do in-person events. Personal project support, Hack the Network events, and Track Summit. So a Track Summit is something which is an annual one-day developer conference that we do every year for each of these tracks. So this will be the first year for us. This is probably, these many number of women are greater than these many number of women. These are all the volunteers for my track who are interested to get into blockchain. Many of them have, so Shari here, you see she's a student, and she didn't even know what blockchain was all about. She just got interested in it, and now she's deep diving into it and trying to understand how to work with identity management and blockchain. So you can see that there's a lot of interest, but what the community needs is support. How can you support? You could be volunteers for our track. You could sign up as speakers, as mentors, technical mentors to mentor these women. You'd probably need like an hour a week just to talk to these women, understand what they're doing, what are their topics of interest, and how can you help them. Hands-on projects and hackathons. If you have any hands-on projects and you think that you need somebody to build a prototype, you can brainstorm it off with our community and help them get access to some real-time problem statements. Last but not the least, spread the word in your community. So one thing that you could do today, or if at all you could take one thing away from today, is to really nudge somebody, women you know in your network, in your community, to, if not women who code, if not blockchain, then definitely understand that tech has potential and really nudge them to get into tech. There are a lot of support communities that are there to support them, a lot of communities to you know, help them build what they want. Especially mid-career women have a lot of blockers to learn new technologies. So if you can just nudge one person today, that would be a great move towards, you know, the next technical industry revolution. I wanted this to be the last slide for my talk, but I have this other slide which I thought can be more impactful. So let me just end with this very statistic-oriented quote. My CEO, every time in her presentation since 2018, has been telling that there are 600,000 plus jobs that are needed to be filled. And it is women who you know, need to come forward, because these jobs are there. Men are already taking it up. But the industry really needs more and more women to fill this job in order to get a diverse portfolio. So it is a humble request from the tech industry that, dear women, we need you. Thanks, guys. Also, thank you so much to the organizers of this event, Blockchain India, to give me an opportunity to come out here and really talk about diversity and the need for diversity. I can't emphasize it enough. And one of the other really awesome and cool things that I found out at the hackathon was that an all-girls team had a special prize, but I had already made my team by then. But hey, you know, kudos to you guys. Yeah, you guys are doing a great job, and yeah, all the best.
Thank you. Some really nice words from your end, and even you are doing a great job, Ganalakshmi. Moving on to our next session, which is a panel on adding to our bottom line diversity and innovation. I would like to call upon Tabassum, who is a core team member and handling our branding, to as a moderator for the panel. Our first panelist is Anna Melton, who's running Decentralized Ventures. Second panelist is Jessica Zartler. You have been seeing her a lot on the stage. Third panelist is Lekha Satish. She is leader for blockchain and innovation at KPMG. And I'd like to call upon Ganalakshmi again as a panelist.